seventh commandment, you shall not commit adultery. And last week, as we dealt with this commandment, we looked specifically at the Old Testament scriptures. And today we're going to be looking and moving this ahead to the New Testament and seeing how it is applied by both Christ and his apostles in a greater way, taking it deeper into the hearts of those that desire and profess to serve him. It's a serious issue, although I'm going to start off a little bit lighthearted, because I also believe that this is something that as we look at in each and every one of our lives, is something that we all have to deal with. This isn't one of those subjects that we can look at someone else and say, "Boy, I'm glad that I'm not like that, and I'm glad that, you know, I don't have that problem." I think this problem is universal. The statistics we looked at last week show that this is a universal problem. And today, as we begin, we want to understand that right up front, that we all have issues, and we have issues with sin, and we need to deal with those issues in light of a God that not only forgives and gives us an abundance of his grace, but a God that also restores. And that as we live our lives out before the Lord, there can be actual changes made in our lives so that we go from getting face to face with the Word of God and understanding what the Word of God says and the power of the Holy Spirit, we go out into society that we can live different type of lives. We don't have to react as the world does. Adultery is an issue that affects our marriages. It affects our marriages because we have problems in our marriages. We all have problems in our marriages, but the issue is, what do you do with them? What do you do with them? Do you experience the grace of God and the power of God to change those dynamics that are causing problems in your marriages, or do you try to escape? Get out of what God has called you to do. Mona Reston was on trial for the murder of her third husband, and the district attorney asked her, "What happened to your first husband?" And she said, "Well, he died of mushroom poison." Then he asked her, "Well, what happened to your second husband?" She said, "Well, he died of mushroom poison too." Then he said to her, "Well, what happened to your third husband?" Mrs. Reston replied, "Well, he died of a skull fracture." And the prosecutor asked, "Well, why did this happen?" Mrs. Reston thought for a few minutes and said, "Well, he didn't particularly like mushrooms." It's not only women, though, that get frustrated with their husbands. One man put this ad in the newspaper. Now, this is back when I was young, so you got to contextualize it a little bit here. It said this: "For sale, complete 25-volume set of Encyclopedia Britannica. Latest edition, never used. Wife knows everything." You know, we all have problems, but what we do when our spouses frustrate us and perplex us and anger us tells us the extent of our understanding of the Word of God and the depth of our relationship with Jesus Christ. And the Bible only really gives us one answer today, is that no matter what is happening in your marriage, deal with where your heart is before the Lord and never, never, never stop trusting in the power of the love of Jesus Christ. Never stop loving. Never, never, never. Allow the Holy Spirit to lead you. Walk in the way of Jesus Christ. What's the problem? The problem is that both husband and wife are the problem. And when we begin to look outside of our God-given spouse to someone else, we just create a bigger problem within our lives. It never gets better. And we apply that today to all kinds of looking outside of our spouses, to conversations, to relationships, and to pornography. And we're going to continue with that theme this week also. There is no blame game. There are no excuses that we can make with ourselves and say, "You know what? This is what they did to me, so I have the right to go ahead and do this. I have the right to look at that. You don't know what kind of woman God you gave me. You don't know what kind of husband my man is. So you've got to understand, God, that I've got to be allowed a little leeway here to do some things that maybe you wouldn't quite approve of." It's all a game. And it all comes back to you and your relationship before God. That's where it all comes to. And when we look to solve our problem, I think our spouse's problem might just look and become a little bit less significant. Well, in the Bible today, I'll give you three problems that we need to deal with as we watch over ourselves. My goal today, to give you a few handles on how to solve the problem. We've already identified what the problem is. We see what it is out there. We see what it is in here. But now we want to see what this problem is inside of us, and we want to learn to take care of it. Well, first, there's the watching problem. Watching problem. It's a heart issue, and we need to learn to watch over the condition of our hearts. We need to learn to guard our hearts by the Word of God. We need to look inside and say, where are we at, and what is causing us to do things that aren't in line with the Word of God, and to do things that we know that the Lord Jesus Christ would not approve of within our lives. Well, what's the problem? Well, some people have advocated today that when you come to know Jesus Christ, that God gives you a new heart. And then when he gives you a new heart, that now all you have to do in your life is live out of that heart. In other words, it's more of a matter not of just knowing and applying the Word of God. I just kind of live and trust in what's happening inside of me, live out of that. And then by doing that, then I will not going to have any problems within my life. My actions will be righteous. The way I think is going to be righteous. All I got to do is live out of my heart. I don't agree with that. When the Bible uses the word heart also, it doesn't mean the physical organ. It's not something there in your chest. That's not what the heart is. As a matter of fact, when the Bible describes the heart, it often uses the term mind to describe the heart. Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So it's not just a matter of emotion. It's not just a matter of a feeling. The Bible says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So it also deals with the mind, the intellect, and the feelings, the passions, all of those things. And so it's not just the physical organ. We don't just live out of that because it's completely righteous. God does not somehow give you a brand new heart and mind that cannot be touched by temptation or the problems of sin. So you can actually be in your salvation, have a heart that isn't where it's supposed to be before the Lord at any particular time. The heart still has problems. So take your Bibles and go with me. We'll go into the Gospels first and go with me to Matthew chapter 15, and we're going to look at verse 19. Matthew chapter 15, verse 19. What is the problem with our hearts, and we're going to deal with what in the world we can do about it. Matthew 15, verse 19. Jesus said this. He said, out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony, and slander. And I believe this belongs to Christians today. I believe that every one of us in here is capable of any one of these activities, as we saw in the example of David, that we're capable of any of these type of things if we don't watch over our hearts. We may not think so, but I guarantee you things can happen in the lives of Christians and our hearts can get out of control and we'll start doing stuff we would never conceive that is possible. So we really have to watch our hearts, because all of those type of things, I believe, still can come out of our hearts. No matter how, you know, wicked they are, our hearts still need or have issues and need to be changed. Now, I understand this. I believe this. That when a person is saved, God circumcises the heart by the Holy Spirit. Our hearts are circumcised. In other words, the mind, the heart, the emotions, all those things are affected by the relationship that we have with Jesus Christ. And when God circumcises the heart, he puts the heart in a position through the work of Christ, the atonement of Christ, and the righteousness of Christ, where we have two things. We have the mastery over sin. That now we have the ability to say, no, I don't have to do that. If I do that, it's willfully my decision, and I am not under the control of that wicked thing. So the heart has been given the mastery over sin. And we see that today in Romans 6, 19 to 22, where it says that we've got to get our lives out of the place of being slaves to the flesh, being slaves to sin, and subject ourselves to the Lord Jesus Christ and subject our passions to Him and not be a slave under the dominion of the sin that is causing us these different issues, whether it has to do with our mates, it has to do with thoughts that we have about getting out of our marriages, or whether it has to do with looking at pornography or any of those type of issues, that we have the dominion to be a slave to Christ and not to to have those things exercising dominion over us. We don't have to. You can't say the devil made me do it because the devil didn't make you do it. You subjected yourself as a slave to that which Christ redeemed you from. You don't have to do it. You don't have to do it. And then secondly, what he does with our heart is he makes it moldable. In other words, the heart can be changed. The mind can be changed. The passions can be changed. And that when we get serious before the Lord, like we did earlier here, we talked a little bit about repenting. And we not only sang a song, but we had a little time in prayer in terms of repenting and things we need to deal with in our lives. When we do that, moment by moment, issue by issue within our lives, guess what? God changes the heart. If you're here today and you say, you know what? I've been in it too long. We're just too deep. My wife has caused me so many problems. My husband's caused me so many problems. There's just no way we can get it all straightened out. The only solution is a divorce. That is not consistent with both what the Word of God teaches and what the power of God can do within your life. You do not have to get a divorce. I don't care how long you're in the process. You do not have to get a divorce. God can do a work in your heart. He can do it day by day, moment by moment, and you can be changed. You can be completely different. You can be different when you leave this church this morning than you were when you walked in. You can be different tomorrow than you are today. No excuses. We can look to Christ and we can find the strength and the power of Christ within our lives to get rid of the sin. The dominion of sin is taken away. It is cut out of my mind. It is cut out of my heart. It does not have to master over me. Begin there today. You've got a problem, just say to the Lord, you know what? You know, I'm going to start exercising your righteousness right now in my life. I don't have to do this any longer. I'm done with what I'm looking at on the computer screen. I'm done with the way I'm thinking about my mate. That's it. God, Satan doesn't have control over me because I'm a redeemed child of God. You got to watch over your heart. You got to see where your heart's at and then deal with it. And an unguarded heart can be a playground for uncontrolled passions, especially when you think about our society and all of the visual, you know, stimuli that's coming into our eyes and then down into our lives. You got to watch over your heart. Well, what's the solution? You have the power in Jesus Christ not to be not tempted, but to resist the temptation. What do? Go to Matthew chapter 5, verse 27. Matthew chapter 5, verse 27, where Jesus deals directly with this issue of adultery. Matthew 5, verse 27. Now, Jesus is referring back to the law of Moses, and he quotes the seventh commandment, and he says this: "You've heard that it was said, 'Do not commit adultery.' But I tell you that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart." So see, what does Jesus do? See, Jesus says, you know, it's not just about action. It's not just about, well, you know, I didn't really go do anything with my next door neighbor. I didn't really go do anything with that man or our woman at work. You know, and when I get on the computer or magazines or whatever I do, you know, I'm not really doing anything. I'm not really, you know, I'm not really entering into relationships with those people. Well, Jesus takes the command and he says, if you look at another woman, and this could apply for women too. We've seen that in the statistics, one out of three women are also engaged in pornographic and or conversations or are visualizing pornography also. And so we have to look at this idea and understand that it's not just about me and my private thinking. It's not just about, well, God doesn't see it. No one's going to get hurt by it. It's not just, you know, it's a matter of action. It's not just a matter of what's going on inside me. No, guess what? It's a matter of what's going on inside you all of the time. Jesus says it's part of what's happening within the heart. Well, what do? Well, when we desire to solve our issues, especially issues that deal with our sexuality, outside of our God-given spouses, outside of God-given purity, what do we need to do? We need to do some spiritual surgery. That's what the next part of our text says. There's some things that we just need to change. What does he say? Verse 29. If your right eye causes you to sin, gouge it out and throw it away. It's better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. Now, he's referring to this issue of adultery here, just so you know that. This is the application. This is what you do. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away, for it's better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to go into hell. Now, what's he saying? Is he saying that we have to begin to mutilate ourselves? Well, number one, understand that he's saying here is the issue isn't necessarily your partner. The issue's you. You're going to have to deal with your situation and do what's necessary in your situation to avoid adultery, which is looking lustfully at another man or another woman. You've got to be able to deal with it by doing what? Cutting it off, taking care of it, removing yourself specifically from those situations in your life that is causing that lust or those desires, those inappropriate desires to happen. You need spiritual surgery of the heart. There's a Dr. Roloff that I was listening to this last week. He's long gone to be with the Lord. And Dr. Roloff was teaching about how we need spiritual surgery. And he says to get spiritual surgery, first of all, you need to go to Dr. Law. Why do you go to Dr. Law? Well, you go to Dr. Law to find out what your problem is. And he talks about a man that went into Dr. Law. And he went into Dr. Law and he said, Dr. Law, I got a problem with my feet. And Dr. Law said, well, what's wrong with your feet? He says, my feet take me places I shouldn't go. I really don't want to go, but my feet take me there. Dr. Law says, you don't have a problem with your feet. He says, well, then it's a problem with my hands because I have things that I do with my hands that just aren't right. Dr. Law said, you know, it's not your hands. And he said, well, wait a minute, it's my eyes. My eyes see things that I shouldn't see. And Dr. Law said to him, no, it's not about your feet, it's not about your hands, it's not about your eyes, it's about your heart. Well, this man got all upset. He said, how do you know that? You haven't even looked at my heart. You wouldn't know these things. He said, well, then you better find a doctor that can understand the inner person. Well, that's Dr. Grace. That's the power of God working in and through His forgiveness and His righteousness to change what's happening inside of you. And if you come to understand that the problem is your heart, then the next thing that you have to do is, in desire before God to fix the problem, is you need to begin to cut off those places of temptation that cause you to sin. See, that's the response of Jesus to the issue. Start cutting it off. Guess what? You can't sit. If you have a problem with lust, you've got a problem with another woman or another man, you got a problem with the computer, you can't sit in front of it day after day. You can't be in an improper relationship day after day and say, God, I just want you to fix my heart. That isn't going to do it. You deal with your heart before the Lord, and then you become obedient to the scriptures, and you sever those relationships and those activities in your heart that are causing you to sin and causing you to stumble. You just don't keep doing it. And what does that mean? That means there's some people here today that need to stop watching the TV because it causes you to stumble. It arouses your passions and you think things you ought not to think and you plan things you ought not to plan. Then you need to cut it off. I'm not saying you can't watch TV, but some of you ought not to watch TV. Some of you ought not to be on the computer. You've got to be careful with that. We saw last week in the statistics that over 70% of those in the workplace, 70% in the workplace while they're at work are going to pornographic sites. It's only going to get you into trouble. And it's wrong before the Lord. You got to deal with that. Guess what? You got to cut it off. You might not have to gouge out your eye. You know, that's cut off your hand. But guess what? If you can't resist that temptation, you better quit your job. Because your holiness before Christ is more important than the buck you earn at your job. Deal with it. Cut it off. That's the first thing that Jesus says to do. No, it can happen anywhere. It can happen at the store. I read of a woman, she went up to the store, and she was in a hurry, and she had a few things to check out, and she went up to the counter, and the young man behind the counter was on the telephone. And she said, sir, I'm in a hurry. Could you please check me out? He took his ear away from the phone, looked her up and down, and said, not bad. All right, well, there's another man and a woman. They went up, and actually this was a pastor that I know, and they went up to a counter at a grocery store, and he said the woman behind the cashier, the woman behind the counter was absolutely gorgeous, drop-dead gorgeous, just beautiful. And he said his wife was over there dealing with the money. She had her eyes down. She never looked up. So he just decided he was going to check her out. So he kind of looked her up and down, you know, like you ought not do. And after he did that, his wife, he said his wife, her eyes never came up. And his wife said to him, was it worth the trouble you're in? It can happen anytime. You've got to watch over your heart. I mean, it's not that you have to watch TV, but I'll guess what? You know, those commercials are going to come. And there's things that you ought not to be watching and seeing. And you're going to have to find a way to deal with that. Just get it done. I think one of the biggest problems that men have today, we've got too much time on our hands. And if you're like David walking around on the roof of his palace when he ought to be out at war, it's time for you to engage in some other battles in your life. Get active in fighting the battle of the Lord so you're not running or sitting around getting on the computer and thinking about things that you ought not be thinking about. So watch your heart. Know the truth of the Word of God. Cut those issues and those practices off that are getting you in the problem. Determine to walk in obedience. Now, I don't know how we sometimes do it as Christians, and we deceive ourselves because we know that in 1 John, the Bible says that if any man says that I come to know him, and doesn't obey his commandments, he's a liar, and the truth is not in him. And so when we're in the church here, and we hear that there are women that are in adulterous relationships, men that are in relationships, people that are looking at pornography, we have a right to look at you and suspect that there is indeed a problem with your relationship with Christ and maybe a problem with your salvation. Why? Because you are not sincere in obeying the word of Christ. What did Christ say? Cut it off. Gouge it out. Take care of it. Put yourself in a position in life where you're not having to sin before the Lord. Well, that's the watching problem. Secondly today, there's a walking problem. The second issue is a spirit issue, a Holy Spirit issue. And we need to be dedicated to walking in and by the power of the Holy Spirit. What is that? That is a moment-by-moment application of the Word of Christ and the righteousness of Christ to every situation that we're in. It's to learn in our lives that as we take every step that we walk out within our society, within our homes, wherever we're at, we begin to trust in, rest in, yield to the power of the Holy Spirit as it applies the Word of God to our need. Now take your Bible. We'll move ahead to Paul's teachings. Go to the book of Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5. We're going to begin reading with verse 16. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. There the Apostle Paul writes, "So I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature." Live by the Spirit, or walk by the Spirit. "For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in conflict with each other, so that you do not do what you want." Now, Paul deals with this issue also in Romans 7, and he says, there is a battle going on inside of me. And in this battle, many times there's something I want to do, but guess what? There's something also inside of me that leads me to do just the opposite of what I want to do. And you need to discover today that your resource is walking in and by the power of the Holy Spirit moment by moment. What does it mean to walk by the Holy Spirit? Well, the Holy Spirit is both the person and the power of God in your life, brings the presence of Christ's righteousness right to the moment of your need. You're sitting there, you got time on your hands, and you are tempted to push some buttons you ought not push. Or if you're in a troubled relationship in your marriage, you're maybe tempted to think some things. Maybe a divorce might be a good idea. I don't know that he's ever going to change. I don't know that she's ever going to change. Guess what you need to do? Your resource is the Holy Spirit of God that can help you and give you the strength by giving you the righteousness of Christ in and through the Word of God, and apply that at that moment to experience his resurrection power and say, "Christ, I don't have to do this anymore. You're the power that is living within me, and I'm going to be obedient to what your word says. I'm going to cut it off. I'm going to gouge it out. I'm not going to do it anymore. I don't have to." Yield yourself to the Spirit of God. That's what you do in the midst of desire, in the midst of temptation. That's your resource, the power of Christ. Well, this passage of Scripture is really cool because Paul also gets into restoration. Now, I'd love to believe that the statistics are wrong in relationship to this church. I would love to believe that not half of the men and a third of the women, or two-thirds of the men and a third of the women, are involved in either illicit relationships or in pornography. I'd love to believe that. But the longer I've been a minister in a church, the more I've realized that we sometimes can run pretty close to the statistics that are given in our society at general. That sometimes the church is no better, which means that a significant number of us sitting here today have a problem. We're seeing things and thinking about those things, and we've got heart problems that we're not dealing with. We've got activities that we shouldn't be doing, and we're making plans that we ought not be making. And if that's true, then guess what? We need to find restoration. We need to find restoration. We need to get our lives right before God, and we need to do it quickly. Well, Paul addresses that in chapter 6. Look at chapter 6, verse 1. And he does it, interestingly, in a community sense. He says, Brothers, if someone is caught in a sin, you who are spiritual, or literally in the context of this text, you who are spirit-filled, you who are spiritual, should restore him gently. But watch yourself, or you also may be tempted. By the way, there, the word restore is the same as setting a fractured foot, setting broken bones. That you who are filled with the Spirit and walking by the Spirit have a responsibility to help fix the problems that others are having. Look at verse 2. It says, carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. In other words, our restoration is to be a product not only of our own individual activity, but it's to be a communal thing. In other words, the Holy Spirit dwells within the church on an individual and on a communal level. In other words, when I cannot find the power to change what I need to change in my life, what do? You go to your brothers and sisters in Christ. If you have a brother or sister in Christ that is struggling with either adultery, fornication, internet porn, anything like that, guess what? It's your responsibility to go to that person and begin to deal with that issue. Now, we need to, you might say, you know, I don't want to get involved with that. That gets, you know, I got to talk about things I don't want to talk about. And you talk to my wife, I don't like any of this stuff. You know, my problem is I go to Christians, I'll say, you know, I've heard you've been doing this. And they'll say, well, yeah, I got a problem with that. Take care of it. That's my solution. You know, I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to talk about what you've been doing. I don't want to talk about what you've been seeing. I don't want to talk about what you've been feeling. Well, I found out something in my life. That doesn't cut it. That's not carrying someone else's burdens. That's just taking whatever their burden is and dumping it all back on them. Bible says we got to learn to carry each other's burdens, which means we have to be willing to get down and deep into the dirty things of their life and say, brother, sister, I know what you're thinking, and I know what you're doing. Guess what? It's not right. And we're going to work this thing through together. I'm going to stand with you. And I'm going to rebuke you, I'm going to challenge you, I'm going to love you, I'm going to assure you of the forgiveness of Christ and the righteousness of Christ, but I'm going to get down there with you, and we're going to get this thing taken care of. If you're out here today, and you know another brother or sister in Christ that's struggling with some of these issues, whether it's considering, you know, getting a divorce or looking at pornography or whatever it is, it's your responsibility to get involved in their life. And I don't mean, you know, it's going to be something you're going to take care of today. You ain't going to take care of it today. This might take weeks. This might take months. This might take years. But you're going to get in there and you're going to stand with them. And you're going to work with them. And you're going to suffer with them until they get to the place where the strength and the power of the Holy Spirit has so captured their minds and their hearts, and that they can then walk away, cut it off, get rid of it within their lives. So it's something that we need to do together. And if you're here today and you say, well, you know, I'm just too deeply involved, I've made too many decisions, and I can't get away from it. No, that's not true. You can be restored before the Lord. You can go before the Lord, and he can give you his grace, and you can have your relationship restored, and your life can become you can become the new creature in Christ Jesus that you need to become. So we need to carry each other's burdens. And just so you know, in the midst of that too, is that if you go to someone else in the church because they have a severe problem, whatever that might be, and they're not willing to respond, then you have to follow the next step of discipline that's given in the Word of God, and that is to take someone else along. If you can't deal with the issue yourself, then take someone else along and go confront that individual. Say, brother, sister, this isn't right. The way you're thinking, what you're doing isn't right. And we're here and we're going to help you. And the Bible says if that doesn't help, then you got to take it to the church, which means to take it to the leaders of the church. And it ends up becoming a progressively more public issue. So you're here today and you say, well, you know, I got a problem, but I don't want everybody else to know. Then if your brother or sister in Christ comes, guess what? You better begin to deal with it before the Lord, or it just may become a public issue. Also, we see in this passage of Scripture your reward. Look at the reward, verses 7 to 9 of Galatians 6. He says, do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. The one who sows to please his sinful nature, from that nature will reap destruction. You're committing adultery by looking lustfully at someone else of the opposite sex. Guess what you're going to reap? You're going to reap destruction. You're going to have more problems than you can believe caused by that sin. You're not going to escape. You're not going to be the one person that, guess what, I got away with it. No, you're not going to be. God's going to make sure you don't. The one who sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. So what's your goal here today? I would have to believe, except for the kids here that don't want to be here, that if you're here today, you want to be part and parcel with Christ in eternity. You want to live with him forever. And you want to begin to experience the quality of eternal life even right now. And that you're here today and you're having a problem that I think you probably want to get it taken care of. Because you want to experience the fullness of the blessing of eternal life in your life beginning right now. That's your reward. And the scripture here only gives you two choices. You're not some type of unusual third person that has different choices. You've got two choices here. You can sow to the sinful nature, or you can sow to please the Spirit. That's it. Make your choice. Choose wisely. Well, lastly today, I'll just talk about one more thing, and that's your resolve. That's your resolve. There are just two ways marked out in Scripture, from the beginning to the very end. And we should resolve to choose not the way of Cain, but the way of Christ. What is the way of Cain? And I've really been studying this the last couple weeks and really came through some experiences as we were studying a build course called The Law, and then some personal experiences I've had as I really begin to see what this means in relationship to the Scriptures. What is the way of Cain? Well, take your Bible and go with me to Jude chapter 11. And I want to give you some parameters of thinking and a way of thinking about your the way that you live both in America and in the world today. And for you to make some judgments about the civilization that we live in and the temptations that it presents. And for you to get some greater perspective on this. So go with me to the book of Jude right before the book of Revelation. And it's only got one chapter. Go down to verse 11. We're going to read verse 11 to 15. I would like to show you the way of Cain. And the reason I'm going to show you this is I want you to understand that what's out there in the world, whether it's in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, whatever state that you live in, whatever country that you live in, the way of Cain defines the whole of that civilization. The whole of that civilization. Verse 11 in Jude chapter 1, verse 11. Woe to them, they have taken the way of Cain. They have rushed for profit into Balaam's error. They have been destroyed in Korah's rebellion. These men are blemishes at your love feasts. Now what does that mean? That means they're in the church. They're in the church, and that's what statistics say. Eating with you without the slightest qualms, shepherds who feed only themselves, clouds without rain, blown along by the wind, autumn trees without fruit, and uprooted, twice dead. They are wild waves of the sea foaming up their shame, wandering stars for whom blackest darkness has been reserved forever. Then it goes on to say, Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men. See, the Lord is coming with thousands upon thousands of his holy ones to judge everyone and to convict all the ungodly of all the ungodly acts they have done in an ungodly way and of all the harsh words ungodly sinners have spoken against him. Now understand that the way of Cain is the way of the civilizations of the world. And that when you choose to enter in not only to practices, but thinking processes about women, about men, about your marriage, about what you have the right to do and see, and you do so not under what the Scripture defines as what is right and wrong, but you do so in relationship to the civilization of this world, that is the way of Cain. And that is the way in the Scriptures called cursing. This way in the Scriptures is defined by the way of the cities of men. Let me show you this, because this is where we're going to conclude today. Because I want you to choose and choose today whether you are going to walk by the earthly cities of men or by the city of the cities of God, the city of God. Take your Bible and go with me to Genesis. Go all the way back to the book of Genesis. Go to chapter 4. It's interesting that this happens twice in the Scriptures, right after the fall of man. And right away, God seems very concerned about establishing two lineages, two ways of life. And he does so right after the fall of man in the beginning of Genesis by defining the way of Cain and the way of Seth. That's the unrighteous way and the righteous way. It is the way of cursing and the way of blessing. The way of cursing, the way of Cain, is talked about in chapter 4, and it begins in verse 17. Now, God curses him a few verses up, but it says in verse 17, as it lays out his lineage, and I want you to see how it describes him in relationship to cities and civilizations. Cain lay with his wife, and she became pregnant and gave birth to Enoch. Now, this is the first Enoch in Scripture, by the way. This is the cursed Enoch. Cain was then building what? A city. Cain was building a city, and he named it after his son Enoch. Well, see, there's the first problem. And here you have to get this idea in your head that when this is being described in this passage of Scripture, the way of cursing, he is literally saying that when men that are cursed build cities, they do it completely from a God-centered and God-purpose perspective. And this is the way that the civilizations of the world are. Okay, so what happens? Cain was then building a city. He named it after his son Enoch, and then he had several children. One of them was Lamech. In verse 19, Lamech married two women, one named Ada and the other Zillah. Now, at this point, what's happening? You have the first polygamy in Scripture, right here in the cursed lineage of Cain. So right away, you start seeing the product of being cursed and not blessed. So what happens next? And this is what I find fascinating in the Scripture, is it almost talks about the accomplishments of this cursed generation with a little bit of pride. In other words, it's like the Scriptures wants us to see that man is incredibly capable of doing great things, doing fantastic things. It's these great and fantastic things that mesmerize us and get us lost in sin, the sins of the culture. What does it say then after that? It says in verse 20, Ada gave birth to Jabal. He was the father of those who live in tents and raise livestock. In other words, this city that was being built, okay, had livestock. It had agriculture that was around the city. What else does it have? It says his brother's name was Jubal. He was the father of all those who play the harp and flute. It not only had agriculture, it had culture. It was a great city. And then what does it say in verse 22? Zillah also had a son, Tubal-Cain, who forged all kinds of tools out of bronze and iron. And so this city also had industry. And it speaks about it in a positive sense. It's incredible what this cursed genealogy of mankind did. And then if you move ahead, and we're not going to look at it today, but if you move ahead to Noah, right after the earth is completely destroyed, why? Because of Cain's lineage, right? What happens next? Well, right away, there's sin in Noah's family. One lineage, Ham's lineage, gets cursed. Cursed be Canaan. Follow down the line from that when you get time, and you're going to find out that lineage decided to build a God-rejecting, man-exalting city. It said the man got together on the plains of Shinar, and he built both a city and a tower that was reaching into heaven. And, of course, you know it as the Tower of Babel. And when I think about the world that we're in today, it is shiny. It has so many fantastic accomplishments. I mean, you look at even the city of Milwaukee. The other night I was sitting in the Bradley Center watching a Bucks game, you know, and I'm not saying there's anything wrong with doing something like that, but I was sitting in there and the advertisements and the flashing lights are going around at the half times, and there's a bunch of scantily clad women dancing and shaking and doing all the things they ought not to be doing out there. And as I was sitting there, I said, you know, this is it. It's incredible, this place. It's incredible what's happening here. And this is the way of Cain. This is all the sensual images and all the great accomplishments of man apart from God. Well, what are we supposed to do about that? Well, I can't say we can completely avoid things like that and that we need to not go to basketball games or not live within our culture, because the Bible says we need to be in the world, but what? not of the world. But guess what? In contrary to the city of Cain, there's another city. It's called the city of God. It's the way of Christ. And we'll finish there today. Go with me, lastly, to Hebrews chapter 11. Because I want all the men and the women that are in this church to make a decision today. I am not going to be attracted by the garbage and the glitter of this world. I'm going to seek for a different city. Go to Hebrews chapter 11 and look at verse 9. We'll start in verse 9. By faith, you're talking about Abraham. He made his home in the promised land like a stranger living in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. What was he looking for? It says in verse 10, he was looking forward to the city whose foundations, whose architect and builder is who? Is God. He's looking for a different kind of a city. A city that wasn't magnifying the greatness of man. That's what you see out there in the world today. Man's exalting, man's pride over what man can do. It's enticing because we look at that and we go, wow, this is fantastic, it's amazing. You got to see these places. See the buildings that man is building. Do you remember what Jesus said when the disciples said to him, said, hey, Jesus, look at these great buildings of the temple. Remember what Jesus said? He wasn't so amazed. He said, guess what? There's not one of these buildings that's going to be standing in this next generation. Didn't mean anything to him. Why? He was part of a different city. He was part of a different culture. Look at verse 16 of Hebrews chapter 11. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be their God, for he has prepared a city for them. And in your midweeks this week, you're going to get into Hebrews chapter 13 and talk about another verse that deals with the city of God. You're here today, and you are following the way of Cain, the cursed way of Cain, not the blessed way of God. You're doing things that you know are absolutely wrong. You're thinking things that you know are wrong. And it may be because you're here today and you're thinking about getting a divorce. You may be, you're doing things on the internet, computers, that you're not supposed to be doing. Guess what? You're being mesmerized and attracted by the way of Cain. You're seeking and looking at and participating in the civilization that is enamored by its greatness, enamored by the pride of man. It's time for you today to lay that aside. Get that taken care of before God. Begin to look at your heart and deal with the issues of your heart. Begin to deal with the issues of the Holy Spirit and whether or not you're going to live and walk by the power of the Holy Spirit. And that you're going to make a decision and you're going to just put a stake down in the ground and say, you know what? I can see what the civilizations of this world, what the city of this world looks like, and I don't want to have anything to do with it. I know I have to live in it. I know I have to go to work in it. I know I have to play and I got to do all those things. I got to live in this world. But guess what? I'm going to be looking for a greater city. I'm not going to be mesmerized by all the great things that man can do and the great immorality that man supposes is often good and is often right. And I will begin today to commit myself to walking not by the way of Cain, but by the way of Christ. I'm done with those practices, that way of thinking. Now I'm going to get help if I need to get help. If I know another brother or sister in Christ that needs help, I'm going to get involved in their life. And whatever it is, I'm going to make sure that the city that we are pursuing here as a community at Fair Park Community Church is the city of God. And I'm going to live and I'm going to walk in that city and I'm going to do what's necessary to have his name written on my forehead so that the world can see and experience what it means to be a child of the living God. Will you commit yourself to that this morning? And if you've got an issue that you're not willing to deal with yourself or can't deal with yourself, that you'll go to a brother or sister in Christ and enter into conversation with them. Go to them and say, you know what? I got a problem, brother. I need your help. I need your prayer. I need your counsel. Get it taken care of. Don't allow these statistics to be true here at Fair Park Community Church. Begin to be what God has called you to be and to live the righteousness of Christ out in your life day by day. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the time together. Thank you for your righteousness. Thank you for your forgiveness and your grace. And I pray today, Lord, that you would help each and every one of us to take a look at our hearts, then to take a look at our practices, and to begin to deal with the issues that we have before you today. And Lord, I pray that you would work mightily on behalf of your word, on behalf of your church, to reach this culture with the name of Jesus Christ and the righteousness that goes with that name. In his name we pray. Amen.